Okay, guys, usually we get right into the show, but I wanted to take just a moment to talk to you all. First of all, the show is now in its 16th year. Very happy about that, and I want to thank you for being here. A number of you have said that you would like to support the show. Well, if you're interested, now you can. If you've ever gotten enjoyment or inspiration from the Paul Leslie Hour, you could become a patron. All you do is go to patreon.com/thePaulLeslieHour, and you're there. All right, let's get into the show.
The Paul Leslie Hour, helping people tell their stories. And now, your host, Paul Leslie.
Hey, it's me. Ladies and gentlemen, we are joined by one of the distinguished pianists of our time, Jim Brickman. Is a musical force of creativity and inspiration. A hit songwriter, he also holds an interesting title, that of best-selling solo pianist of our time. Expression seems to be his forte, whether live performance, his recordings, or his syndicated radio program, The Jim Brickman Show, which you can also hear as a podcast, not to mention his books. So it's great to say welcome to songwriter, performer, pianist, recording artist, and radio show host Jim Brickman. Thank you so much for making the time to talk to us.
It's my pleasure. Nice to talk with you, Paul.
So we had all these titles that we put on you, and no doubt this is a very busy life, and I'm sure very exciting traveling around playing music. But what would you say people don't see about your life?
Well, at the core, to me, the most important thing is having a point of view that is reflected in everything that I do. So I'm not really doing anything that is outside of the core of my mission, which is to connect with people emotionally, to take them on a journey, to romance, to inspiration, to escape, to laugh, to gather, to have emotional and calm moments. And pretty much everything that I do reflects that. So though it sounds like a long resume, the radio show and the books and the concerts and everything, they all dovetail and they all reflect kind of the center of gravity, which is my music.
You just mentioned connecting with people emotionally. And one of the things that I did today, I listened to a lot of your music, but also anywhere I could, I looked for comments. And I have to say, I have not seen many artists where I saw more of an outpouring of personal things, what a song meant to them, or their personal connection to it. And I'm just curious to know, is that something that you look at? Are you someone who maybe looks on a YouTube video for one of your music videos and see the different ways that you've connected with people?
I have over time, but because I started the career before there was social media, most of what I'm used to is getting that one-on-one and listening to people's comments after the live performance or in any sort of forum where it's face to face. And so the comments are amazing and kind and beautiful, but there's nothing better than having people take something that I serve up and taking it the way that I intended for it to be. You know, there's nothing worse than being misunderstood, really. Like, I'm intending to, you know, share a romantic piece with you, and then your reaction is, that doesn't feel very romantic. So then, you know, you want, the best thing is to have people react in the way that you are sharing and understand that that's really what you're aiming to do.
You were talking about connecting with people face to face. What is that like for you? I mean, you are in some cases shaking the hand of someone or saying hi to someone who they have hours and hours that they spend with you because they listen to you. So what's it like on your end when they come up to you and they tell you something like that?
It's very hard to accept, because when you, I think most performers would say that they have a hard time accepting compliments. And I think the reason is because we all, you know, this comes from me, at least I can only speak for myself, in a very, it comes very easily. I don't work hard at it. And I think sometimes when something comes as an artist or a singer or a painter or a dancer or any of those things, of course you learn your craft, but when it comes naturally and I trust what I'm doing and how it is goes through the air and received to somebody else, it's hard to take the compliment, even though I know, of course, they're being honest with me. But I think like most performers or most people who share their gift or their talent with people, it's hard to accept. I'm so appreciative of it. And as you said, people spend hours and hours listening to me. And basically that's like listening to my heart, because that's where it comes from, is deep inside. So it's almost like they know me. They've met me, but I haven't met them.
Is there a mode of expression where you find yourself, it's the most exciting?
Well, live performing to me is my favorite part of what I do. I don't particularly enjoy recording in the studio. Live performing is, you know, is the true test of whether you're affecting people with an immediate reaction to whether they like it or not.
And what about the recording studio? You said you don't particularly like that. Why is that?
It's because you're aiming for a non-existent perfection. There's no such thing as the ultimate take or the, you know, it's not quantifiable, qualitative, and objective. So it could never end, because it's like cooking, or, you know, how do you know when it's done, when the recipe is complete? There's no such thing. It's whatever you make it. And so you have to learn to feel like you've expressed it the way that you want it, you originally intended it for it to be. And for me, most of the time, the first take is the one that we end up using, because it's the most organic. You're thinking about it less. You're not fixing things, like, you know, you haven't taken direction if there's a producer. You know, because once you play it first, then on the second take is usually when a producer, if you're working with one, you know, can you try it a little more, you know, this way, you know, or that way. And so then right off the bat, it becomes somewhat inorganic in a way that is more self-conscious.
Who are the pianists that you love?
I don't love pianists. The reason I say that is because, for a couple reasons. First off, I really think of myself as a songwriter more than a pianist. I play the songs that I write on the piano, or I sing them, but I'm not a pianist, like virtuoso. I'm a songwriter who plays those songs on the piano, and I'm a composer, which is a big distinction that sometimes I don't think people understand, that interpreting Brahms, Beethoven, jazz composer, pop song composer, interpreting work is a completely different thing than composing and playing your own music. I mean, I think that's a lot of the reason you see the comments that that you see is because I'm not playing covers. I'm playing original thoughts and ideas. So it's very authentic to what it, how it started from the person who started it, as opposed to interpreting something that someone else did. So I'm more of a fan of songwriters, because that's how my pieces are structured. They're a lot of times they're, even on the instrumental piano, they're verse chorus, or they're verse verse chorus bridge, or they're, you know, verse, you know, pre-chorus chorus. I mean, they're not intentionally structured. It's just that that's how I write, because now I know inherently how to write a pop song. So it's a big distinction, and that's why I'm more of a fan of, you know, what I grew up with, 70s, Carole King, Simon and Garfunkel, Beatles, Joni Mitchell, James Taylor, Fleetwood Mac, the Eagles, Linda Ronstadt. These are all a lot of my influences. And I'm also a big fan of great singers. So though I am a pianist, of course, that's what I do, whereas I started out doing mostly what I do. But because of all the songs that I've written that feature great singers on my albums, I'm really a songwriter.
Speaking of these great artists that have worked with you, what is that like when you have someone like Johnny Mathis and you get to go into a recording studio with, I mean, arguably one of the best singers that has ever been? Is that at all intimidating?
It's surreal is what it is. It's more surreal than it is intimidating. I don't know why. I think you just can't believe it's happening to you. Because when you meet the people that you admire, or that you grew up admiring, you know, in my case, this has happened so often, and it doesn't completely compute, but what I've noticed happens is, at very first, there's that moment, you know, when you meet just as human beings, and then, you know, it's intimidating. But then when you start to work with the person, then it becomes, you're both working together. So it's not, for some reason, I don't find that they're judgmental, especially if they're singing one of my songs, because then they've already heard the song. They already want to sing it in advance before I meet them most of the time. So there's sort of a standard that's already been vetted, you know, that I know that they think there's quality there. And I hope that by reputation, they've asked their friends, or what's it like to work with him, or, you know, the same thing. What I also notice is that they, you know, we're all the same, you know, in the sense, I mean, artistically, I mean, in the sense that, you know, Johnny Mathis is singing the song, and he'll say after the take, you know, how was that? Did you like that? And I'm like, you're asking me, you know. But same with Kenny Rogers was like that. And Carly Simon was like that. And Olivia Newton-John like that, because they're like all artists, they want to be liked. They want to, you know, they want the take to be, I mean, they know that it's going to be on recording forever too. So, and you know, it's a vulnerability to put yourself out there, no matter how big a star you are. But it's still intimidating to me.
I noticed a lot of connections with you and country music, not only great singers from country who have recorded your songs or worked with you, but also, you know, I was listening to your Dolly Parton interview. I listened to the Trisha Yearwood interview that you did. I'd be curious to know, what does Jim Brickman think of country music?
Well, in all music, and this goes for every genre, I've always taken the approach that music is music. You know, like Martina McBride, let's say, is not a country singer. She's a singer who chooses repertoire that is a in a country category, let's say. You know, so if you listen back to like Linda Ronstadt, who is one of my favorite singers of all time, you know, that stuff in retrospect sounds so country, a lot of it. The Eagles sound so country, you know, and based on what we categorize as that. And yet at the time it wasn't. So to me, it's about the singer and their ability to tell a story. It's not so much the genre. And because I'm a storytelling songwriter, you don't find as many great singers who tell a story in pop music. You find, and they're also not accessible to me. Like at the very beginning, the only people that'd be interested in singing one of my songs at the very beginning were country singers, because, or Christian or jazz or something, because most of the great pop singers, at least at that time, were like Whitney Houston, Mariah Carey, or, you know, and they're not going to sing some like first album solo piano player song. So it was a kind of, I would say, means to an end. It accomplished all the things that I was looking for: a great singer to sing a song of mine, and a genre that didn't know me, so I could get exposed to another category of music. But to me, in the end, it's all music, just music.
I was listening to that song, Never Alone, and I'm curious to know, what was it about that one that pulled you in?
Well, you know, I had worked with one of my songwriter co-writers, Victoria Shaw, had discovered this group, Lady Antebellum. And she took, before they were signed, she took me to see a showcase. And they had been singing some of my demos. You know, when you write a song to sell it to someone else, like Trisha Yearwood, they would sing it in their, you know, early days. And so Victoria said, well, why don't they sing Never Alone? It'll be a good way for them to start to get known and featured on one of my albums. And that was sort of the, you know, first time that they had a song that played on the radio, and it introduced them to the audience, but also the industry. And it's just a special song. And with regard to what I was saying before, they're an example of, to me, they're Fleetwood Mac, you know. So yeah, they got their start in country and they crossed, but basically they're it's a pop group. It's just that when you enter the music business, it's easier to enter through the country door than it is the pop door, because there's so many more opportunities in country. There's more artists, there's more radio stations, there's more festivals, there's more live gigs than in pop music. So it's a more accessible way to begin a career.
What's the approach that you take when you interpret one of the songs that we call the standards? I was listening to your version of Over the Rainbow, an absolutely breathtaking version of it. What kind of method do you use to interpret a song like that?
Well, like I said, for the first, you know, 14 albums of mine, I didn't do any covers. And I only started doing them after people knew my style and could recognize that, you know, I had a distinctive style that sounded different. But the key to me of those songs is not reading it from the sheet music. It's finding it under your fingers by ear, because a lot of times that's where you find the really good substitute chords, and then you're free to interpret in your, you know, inside, as opposed to having, you know, when your eyes are connected to sheet music, then it's just mechanics that take over. Oh, that's an E chord, that's what I'll play, as opposed to maybe thinking that it's a different chord, even though it originally wasn't, but playing it and having it sound really pretty. And so I try my best to feel my way around what I know of a song like that. Either listen to a recording and then just turn it off and then try to feel around it. Because as a composer, you can add little things here and there that, you know, that make it sound like my style. There's also one of the most important things about interpreting any song or writing is that the silence is equally as important as the sounds. There have to be moments of breath and silence in phrasing in order for people to really connect, in my view, because if you don't give people a chance to take it in during a little bit of a silence, then it just becomes noise, not music. So, you know, dynamics make a huge difference.
Do you have any dream collaborations in terms of writing, recording, any of that?
I do. You know, I you said I had Dolly Parton on the phone, and you know, she would be one of my dream collaborators as a singer. I would say, and this just happened to me, which is I'm still kind of in shock from, but I had always wanted to write with Burt Bacharach. And I recently met him by phone and email. I was connected with him, and it was just, I'm still in, you know, when he left me a voicemail, and I thought, how do you keep a voicemail forever? Because I don't even care if I ever write with him. He just left me a voice message. That's all I care about. I can play it for people where he says, "Hi, Jim, it's Burt Bacharach." But that I'm waiting for the chance to do that. He's, you know, he's in his early 90s. And so I'm hoping that I will have the chance to do that. He still tours.
Yeah.
Which is amazing. And so that would be up there. And I, you know, it would be amazing to have somebody like Barbara Streisand sing one of my songs. You know, these are not, if I really, really pushed and worked really hard at it, it probably could happen. But sometimes you don't want to do that. Sometimes it's better to just leave it alone. You know, sometimes it's like you have to be careful what you wish for, but not necessarily because of the personality or something, but because it has to be the right song. It's not right to just do it to do it. Like, oh, I did a duet with Dolly Parton. No, what song did you do? We did Silent Night or something. It's sort of like, yes, that's nice, and it would be in my interpretation, but I'm not sure what it does for anybody other than ego for me, you know?
Wow. Very interesting. And wow, how cool about Burt Bacharach.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Or just the idea that he knew who I was, that was shocking also. But, you know, when those moments come along, you know, they remind you of what you've worked hard for. They remind you of, it's a validation of the work that you do and the time and heart and passion that you put into it. When people, not only people who come to the concerts and fans react, but also industry people who you respect.
I want all the listeners out there to go to jimbrickman.com, jimbrickman.com. So for all the listeners, what is on the horizon? What's coming up with Jim Brickman?
Well, one of the things that I'm fascinated with is the different styles of music that I haven't ventured into, but with my approach. So I just finished working on a bossa nova album that I don't know anything about Brazilian music, but I love to listen to some of Sergio Mendes or some of Herb Alpert's things. And so I listened to a lot of it, but I've never written that way. And so I just played the way that I felt like bossa nova, what I thought it sounded like, rather than, again, imitate. But so I'm working on that. I have a real desire to take my live show and and turn it into a Broadway type of experience that's more of a, that has more of a, an arc that is, that has moments, you know, my show, but with like my concert now, but a more theatrical version of that. So I'm working on that. And my advocacy for young people and young songwriters, I'm starting, I have one foundation with my alma mater, Cleveland Institute of Music, but I'm working on a new opportunity to support young musicians and songwriters and advocate, you know, my knowledge. I think it's really important to give that to people who are in pursuit of what I have done in my life. I think it's a special thing to be able to encourage and enlighten people who want to do that. If they're interested, sometimes they're not. Sometimes these days, sometimes it's more like, you know, yeah, we know what to do. We don't need you to tell us. But, you know, not everybody's like that, of course. But, you know, it's kind of funny when it is. But so I'm working on that. And then we're about to head out on our holiday tour. So this is the 23rd year of my holiday concert tour. And one of my favorite times of year to be able to perform, and it's a very joyful thing every single night because people are in a great mood. They want to hear music. It's a gathering, it's community, it's celebration, it's escape.
Wonderful. My last question, I put all these labels on you, songwriter, pianist, performer, recording artist. How would you define Jim Brickman?
Well, I always start with songwriter because it encompasses so much of really what I do. I create music. So I write songs, I perform those songs, but at the essence, it's about sharing music that is something people can use however they feel like they want to, as a soundtrack of life, a background to intimate moments, a background to celebration moments, to, you know, tender moments, sad moments, happy ones. You know, music is gives us a great ability to daydream, to go inward. It's permission to, when you don't have quiet and you have a hard time being in quiet, to let your mind wander. A lot of times music is a way to take you on a, you know, internal journey, a soul searching journey a lot of times. And I don't mean metaphysically, I just mean that it, you know, it's, it gives you a boost and a little support when you want to give a emotional backdrop to something happening in your life. If it's the right kind of music, of course.
Absolutely. Well, Jim Brickman, time is such a valuable thing. I thank you so much for spending some time with us.
It's my pleasure. Thank you.
My pleasure. JimBrickman.com. Thank you again. Until next time. Hey, before you go, if you've ever gotten enjoyment or inspiration from one of my interviews, maybe this one, consider being a supporter on Patreon. All you have to do is go to patreon.com/thePaulLeslieHour. All right, folks. Thanks so much. But this is a young goodbye.